So I'll share with you another aspect of my own personal story and how I was, you know, really the final push that drove me into activism, into this journey into Palestine. In September of 1997, my sister's daughter, Smadara, was killed in a suicide attack. She was 13 years old. It was in Jerusalem. There was an attack that was ordered and executed by Hamas. And I was living here in the U.S. already at the time, so I took the first plane home as soon as I heard. And this, you know, this was the late 90s. Some of you remember the mid to late 90s. There was a lot of violence going on. And so it was always big news when there was violence. But this time, one of the victims was the granddaughter of a famous general. My father had already passed away by then. And not only was he a famous general, but he was a famous general that became more famous because he talked about peace with Palestinians. So by the time I reached Jerusalem, my sister's apartment was packed not just with people who came to express their sorrow, but with reporters. It was insane. Every language, every news agency around the world was there to report this. And the questions that people always ask are, number one, who's responsible? And number two, how do we get them? And how many of them do we kill in revenge, in retaliation? Well, when my sister came out to talk to people after the funeral, the first thing she said was, no real mother would want to see this happen to any other mother. No mother would want to see this grief fall upon any other mother. Don't talk to me about killing more people. Certainly not in my name. Now, there are many Palestinians who came to express their sorrow as well, and my sister was accused of, you know, her willingness to speak to the other side, to, you know, to have the enemy there. And she said, I'm not speaking to the other side, because when the Israeli Prime Minister called and asked to come and visit, he was told not to come. By the way, it was Netanyahu, who was Prime Minister then as well. She said, because the responsibility for this lies on the Israeli government. They are the culprits. They are the other side. When you maintain a brutal occupation, when you steal people's land, and you blow up their homes, and you put their fathers and brothers in jail, and you shoot their children in the schoolyards, and you deprive them of water, and travel, and work, and food, and hope, this is the price that we pay. As a society, this is the price that we pay for the brutal oppression and the brutal occupation of the Palestinians. And clearly, both she and her husband said, we hold the Israeli government responsible for our daughter's death. And Benjamin Netanyahu was not welcome to come. He was told not to come. So now, this became bigger news, because here we have an Israeli mother who just buried her daughter, turning the world upside down on us. We know the Palestinians are terrorists, and the Israelis are victims. We know the Israelis want peace, and that the Palestinians can't be trusted. And she's turned the world completely upside down. So she's, since then, become very active and outspoken. Both she and her husband and their three boys are out there talking and so forth about this issue, about reconciliation and ending the violence, and ending the oppression of Palestinians and the occupation of Palestine. In my case, I was already living in the U.S., so I was had to detach myself from this reality and come to San Diego, where nobody could find Palestine on a map if they, you know, had a gun to their head. So, but you can, on the other hand, you can't just go back to work like nothing happened. You can't pretend, you know, you carry this small coffin of a child and you put it in the ground, and your life changes forever, especially when you know and love the child.